This temporomandibular joint, the most used joint in our life, not only us, as animals or whatever, because everybody, when we are started taking our food, we are using this joint only, whether we are taking water or taking food, whatever, the most used joint in our life is TM joint. But the least learnt joint is also TM joint. That's what my personal life. And we should know few important things. Few important things. This is very much essential. How unlocking the jaw. I took the how we are going to read anatomy. We are going to what are the modalities we are going to use. What is meant by disc derangement? What are the conditions can occur? Not necessarily inflammatory arthritis, septic arthritis, osteoarthritis, avascular necrosis, crystal arthropathies, trauma. Especially mandible is a ring. We will start always seeing the symphysis, parasymphysis, fracture, but we will least to bother about the condylar fracture. The disc may be dislocated, the patient may not open his mouth, that is very much essential. Tumor can that what are the interventions we can do. So going towards the topic, TM joint disorders are common, affecting 28% of populations, and mechanical issues, so-called disc derangement. This is the most frequent type of disorders associated with abnormal anatomical relationship between the temporal mandibles. And conditions like ankylosing spondylitis, junior rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis may lead to symptomatic TM joint derangement. Developmental abnormalities, crystalline deposit disease, neoplasms also common sources. Coming to anatomy. Basically, even though we are calling it as synovial joint, it is called as gingalimo-arthroidal. That means two important movements is possible. One is hinge, other one is glide. So translational as well as rotational motions are supported in this. And we are using surface coils. And even you can see the loop coil also, T1, T2, oblique, sagittal, coronal. Whenever there is inflammation or tumor is suspected, we should use GADO. Closed and open mouth views are must. And we have to do real-time dynamic study by seeing the translation. Suppose the patient will say, whenever I am moving to particular extent only, I am seeing this pain. That means we can do real-time, and that also I will demonstrate how we can do the real-time. And less than 3 mm slice thickness is a must. These are the coils. We are having both vendors, Siemens also, we are having United Imaging, both they have given phenomenal, particular specific 4-channel coil that is very much useful. And how to plan, take good FOV. And please look for condyl process of the mandible. And you can see how I am planning over here. One large FOV, other one is small FOV. This small FOV will be less than 100. That is very important. The slice thickness should be 2.5. And you can see how I am planning along the direction. And you can see the how I am planning oblique sagittal also. This should be involving the medial. You can see it should involve the medial to lateral. This is very important. You can see here how we are planning along the ramus. And you can see we are taking the coronal also. This all these things you plan in particular direction we will have. And coming to closed and open mouth, what are the structures we should look? This is a line diagram. There are bony structures. This is a condylar eminence. And there is a process, this is fossa, where it will sit. This is called glenoid fossa or articular fossa. And anteriorly articular eminence is there. Between this, we are having a strong area called disc articular disc. Articular disc is having posterior band, intermediate zone, anterior band. And anterior band is supported by main, one thing it is lateral pterygoid superior belly directly attached with anterior band, and inferior head is attached with anterior process of the condylar process, and posteriorly it is supported by bilaminar zone. All these things we can visualize in our things. This is closed mouth view. What are the things we have to look? See the condylar process. This is a condylar process with cartilage. And this is the glenoid fossa. You can see the glenoid fossa over here. And what we are seeing is intermediate zone. This is posterior band, and you can see the anterior band. This is the classical biconvex appearance of the disc. And what you are seeing is the lateral pterygoid superior belly directly attaching over here. So this is superior belly of lateral pterygoid, and you can see the inferior belly attached to the anterior surface of the condyle, and it will have some fiber attachment to the capsule also. And posteriorly, what we are seeing is a supporting structure of fibrous. This is called as bilaminar zone, and this is posterior band in closed mouth position. It will be seen at 11 o'clock position. If it is 12 o'clock position, means that the posterior band is seen at 11 o'clock positions, because this is very important one. If it is coming anteriorly, means it is anterior disc derangement or subluxation. So we should see the posterior band should be just in front of the posterior process of the condyle andellar process. That is very much essential. And you can see the attachment set that I told. This is the anterior band. You can see the pterygoid. You can see the lateral pterygoid is directly attached to superior belly. Inferior belly will have attachment over the condyle. And you can see the bilaminar zone, which will have this. This is typical. So when we started opening our mouth, what is happening? See, the articular surface from here, it has come to the condylar process, have come anteriorly, and it is aligned with, you can see, the condylar process. And the disc is remaining same. You can see the typical disc, how it is remaining same. This is very much. And this is dividing into superior compartment and inferior compartment. There is no fluid collection. There is no erosions. There is no, all these things are very much essential when we are seeing this. And this is a typical how the dynamic we are doing. And you can see the if you are taking that particular sagittal slices as four, and we are stacking together to the task card auto view, and if you are running the movie, we can able to see the full movement nicely. We can able to see how it is gliding anteriorly, and you can see the disc will not change. Disc will be seen in central portion only. So beautifully we can evaluate how we are doing it real time. We can able to see this nicely. We can able to see this. That is very much essential. And where we are using this CT. CT is very much useful, especially when we are going towards trauma or by seeing the bony structures like erosions. All this can be better evaluated with the CT. That is for that purpose we are using the CT. And imaging of specific disorders, especially internal derangement. Internal derangement defined as abnormal anatomical relationship of a disc to mandibular condyle. A displaced disc may be gone to its original position. It is called as recaptured, and this be often accompanied by audible click. And if the disease progresses, usually the disc may not be not reducible, where limited motion will be the absence of audible click. It is a disease commonly seen in females of 20 to 40 years of age, 5 times common than the male, and the causes are trauma, malunion, and bruxism, stress, primary osseous disorders. There are 3 types of disc derangement: anterior disc displacement, or medial disc displacement, or posterior disc displacement with reduction when the mouth is opened. And the same thing can happen without reduction when the mouth is open. So closed mouth, when we are seeing, it may be dislocated anteriorly or medially or posteriorly, but when making the patient open mouth, that come to original position means it is with reduction. If it is not coming to original position, means it is without reduction. Chronic anterior disc displacement can go for disc perforations and features of degeneration in the rest of the joint. It is the 3rd stage. This is classical appearance of what are the signs we have to look when we are going for disc derangement. And this is condylar process. What we are seeing, you can see the condylar process over here. Normally the disc should be seen at this position. You can see it is so much dislocated anteriorly. You can see the disc is dislocated anteriorly. And the loss of normal biconvex, it has become biconcave. You can see that it is biconcave. It is bulging out. That is very, instead of biconvex, biconcave, it is becoming convex. And it is globular, and it is thickened, and signal changes are gone. And there are bright signals in the posterior laminar zone. So this is very much essential. So it is anterior displacement. The 12 o'clock position, from the 11 o'clock position, it has come anteriorly. Instead of saying between this area, it has come anteriorly. So it's anterior dislocation. It is very important sign. And the shape, instead of becoming biconcave, it is becoming biconvex. It is very important. Or it is becoming thickened. And these are the things. And another one important sign, double disc sign. The post, you can see the inferior belly, it becomes significantly thickened. So it is anteriorly dislocated disc, both looking like a double disc. This is a double disc sign. Thickened inferior belly of lateral pterygoid muscle. And you can see the effusions in the joint also. And the bilaminar zone becoming more bright. So this is very much essential. This is called as a double disc sign of a disc derangement. And this is a closed mouth position, and you can see the disc is dislocated anteriorly. You can see the disc is over here. When the mouth is opened, it has gone back to its original position. You can see it has gone back to original position. This is a disc retraction. It is going for reduction. So disc derangement with reduction. When it is closed mouth, it is anteriorly dislocated. When it is open mouth, it has gone to its original position. It is called a disc derangement with reduction. When it is not going back to its original position, that is called as a disc derangement without reduction. This is closed mouth position. You can see the condylar process over here, and you can see the disc has become so thickened, anteriorly displaced, deformed, buckled, and wavy appearance, very much thickened posterior band, and bright signals in the especially bilaminar zone. This is very classical of anterior disc derangement. When the mouth is opened also, it is not going back to its original position. It is situated in the same position. And this is called as a disc derangement, anterior dislocation without reduction. This is very much essential. And you can see the translational movement also, it is not coming and articulating with, it is not of that much. So reduced condylar translation is also, all these findings we have to carefully look into it. And what is called as stuck disc, it is a one condition where the disc will be same in the position. It is not going back, or it will be same position. In the translationist movement is totally absent because of fibrosis and adhesions. You can see the closed at the open mouth views. You can see it is looking almost like same position, same, and it is a fibrosed area. These are all very classically seen. So whenever there is no change in open or closed mouth, abnormal shape, thickening, and surrounding low signal fibrosis, it is called as a stuck disc syndrome. That is very much essential. This is another case. You can see in closed, how nicely seen the disc is displaced anteriorly, which is not at all moving back. You can see, and surrounding low signal fibrosis, you can see the low signal fibrosis, and the translationist movement is also very less. It is called as classical of stuck syndrome. The same thing happened here. You can see the globular appearance. You can see the globular appearance. It is buckling inwards. It can see the buckling inwards. It is a closed mouth. What we are seeing here, this is open mouth. It is a very classical of a stuck disc syndrome, which is also quite common when you are not going to treat properly. There are various stages, stage 1 to 5, by seeing this, it is reducing or not reducing, or other osseous changes. By seeing all these things, it is divided into 5 categories. Coming to other conditions, now we learnt the disc derangement, is it normal or is it dislocated? In dislocation, which is coming back to original position, so anterior displacement with reduction, then anterior displacement without reduction, then the osseous changes. Now coming to inflammatory diseases, rheumatoid arthritis or ankylosing spondylitis can occur. This patient not only turned his right or left his head and he is having stiff back, apart from that he is not able to open his mouth also. You can see the classical Anki findings, all Anki findings, full blown, it is bamboo spine. You can see the almost chronic inflammation, the ankylosis of the facet joints. You can see the atlantaxial joint involvement. You can see the TM joint is also almost, there is no disc at all, almost bony ankylosis sclerosis. This is very classical of ankylosing spondylitis. This is coronal sections beautifully demonstrating the bony ankylosis, and you can see the thick fibrosis and ankylosis in the TM joint. The MRI beautifully demonstrating there is no disc at all eroded. This is typical case of Anki with involvement of TM joint. 25% of ankylosing spondylitis patients will suffer from TM joint involvement. Rheumatoid, the characteristic feature is spanus. The second stage is mild erosion. The third stage is severe erosion with the joints and fusion of the joint. You can see the classical spanus, how nicely the spanus is seen. If you are going to give contrast, the spanus will end slowly. You can see the disc is eroded and displaced anteriorly, but the thick spanus is there. You can see thick spanus. This is very classical. After giving contrast, you can see the enhancing thick spanus, and you can be able to appreciate, and started erosions are started overcoming here. These are all very, so enhancing synovium, spanus formations, erosions going for ankylosis, that is very, very classical features of rheumatoid. Junior rheumatoid arthritis also can occur. You can see the thick spanus, and you can see the inflammatory changes over here, and the spanus will be seen as low signal without giving contrast. You can see the anterior disc displacement also can occur, and the CT beautifully will demonstrate the bony erosions. We can see the beautiful erosion of the bony compartment. MR may not give so much importance over the erosions, but we can demonstrate the soft tissue changes. You can see the effusion nicely. You can see the effusion over here, and you can see the soft tissue spanus formation, and you can see the changes in the disc. All these things can be beautifully demonstrated with this junior rheumatoid arthritis can be seen. There are gradings are also there. How much it is involved? Is it erosion of the condyle, or destruction of the condyle, or joint space narrowing, or only changes in the synovium? All these things, by seeing the grading, we can give the what is stage 1, stage 2, or grade 1 or grade 2. Coming to infective arthritis, especially when with the elderly patients, diabetic ketoacidosis or diabetes mellitus of a severe stage, they will go for arteritis externa. That arteritis externa can come down and it will erode the TM joint also. You can see the classical case of arteritis externa coming down and eroding the condylar process with the soft tissue inflammatory changes are there. This is another patient, not of diabetic. You can see the hematogenous spread, infection, condylar process is totally eroded, and you can see the soft tissue subperiosteal abscess in the mesenteric as well as temporalis muscles. Pterygoid muscles are also showing here. This is very important. The child also can suffer, it is a classical features of staph aureus osteomyelitis of the mandible. You can see the mandible showing staph aureus, and you can see the almost involved and subperiosteal abscess is there, and you can see the eroded, and it has gone for condylar process also. It is a very classical. So pediatric age group also can occur. This is classical cases of septic arthritis and osteomyelitis. And like how the knee joint is suffered from osteoarthritis, this can also, because synovial joint, so it will be also more prone to have primary or secondary osteoarthritis. Primary may be commonly seen in elderly individuals. Secondary osteoarthritis may be trauma or disc derangement can also occur. The characteristic features of formation of osteophytes, reduction of joint space, erosion, subchondral sclerosis, end stage will be avascular necrosis. This is classical appearance. See the normal condyle over here. And you can see the subchondral sclerosis, marginal osteophytosis, reduction of joint space, joints, everything what we learned for osteoarthritis will be seen over the joint also. This is sagittal, this is, you can see the coronal, all these findings can occur. And MR beautifully demonstrating how much changes in the condylar process as well as articular eminence, and you can see the disc almost gone and low signal, and you can see the erosions as well as sclerosis and the osteophytes can be better demonstrated with CT. This is very classical. Avascular necrosis, especially subchondral sclerosis, will be more. What we learned, subchondral sclerosis, this double line sign. Double line sign, if you are carefully seeing the subchondral double line sign, can be seen as the low density areas. So you can see over here, apart from sclerosis, and you can see over here, typical appearance of what we are seeing is the OAG has gone for avascular necrosis is very much essential. And you can see the avascular necrosis changes in the condylar process. These are all very classical features of avascular necrosis. CPPD can occur. CPPD, because of chondrocalcinosis, the disc will become calcified. You can see the typical appearance of calcified disc, and you can see the erosions also can. This will be commonly seen with the CPPD. This is classical features of chondrocalcinosis. Like other cartilages, knee cartilages, the DM joint cartilages also will calcifications. Like synovial chondromatosis, multiple loose bodies are also seen over here. Tumor-like conditions, fibrous dysplasia can occur the condyle, and you can see the multiple osteomas, commonly seen with the Gardner syndrome, commonly seen with Gardner. You can see the skull osteomas, mandible osteomas, condylar process osteomas associated with the all. You can see the desmoid tumor of the body, you can see the multiple hematomas, polyps in the colon, all these things features of Gardner syndrome. Osteosarcoma can occur in condyle as well as the rest of the mandibular. This is osteosarcoma in young male, and you can see here, it is a very large case. Rhabdomyosarcoma, from the muscle it has called for destruction of the condyle. This is a case of embryonal rhabdomyosarcoma in a young child presenting as metastasis can occur. It's a case of bronchogenic carcinoma with condylar destruction and cerebral metastasis. So metastasis also can occur in condyle. And this is PET CT beautifully demonstrating the SUV is very high and picking up the SUV, classical case of bronchogenic carcinoma with condylar deposit. And congenital conditions, it may be even hypoplasia or aplasia. The syndromes are golden heart syndrome, tetragolin syndrome, Proteus, Marguyu, and these are all the syndromes. This is classical appearance. This is a normal condyle. You can see the hypoplastic condyle is very much smaller in size, so more prone for derangement as well as degeneration. And you can see the small condyle over here. You can see the small hypoplastic condyle. And you can see the hypoplastic, and this is the 3D face, how nicely demonstrating the one half of the face is almost hypoplastic. This is classical features of Tetragolin syndrome. Sometimes condylar hyperplasia can occur. Whenever it is hyperplastic, means lateral displacements are quite common. Coming to last area, trauma to the TM joint. It may be of low condylar fractures or high condylar fractures. Low condylar fractures not much important. High condylar fractures are very much essential because it will go for disc derangement. This is where one among the case you can able to see the condylar process has gone for fracture on both sides. If you are taking coronal images, you can see the disc instead of normal position. This is a normal position. You can see the disc is displaced medially. You can see the how much disc is displaced. You can see the disc is displaced along with it is rolled up. So it is a classical. Whenever we are having high condylar fractures, it will go for disc derangement and dislocation. Not necessarily anteriorly, medial dislocation is also quite common. You can see the anterior as well as medial dislocation. You can see the anteriorly dislocated. You can see the condylar process over here and the disc is displaced anteriorly. You can see the medially, the same disc. And the same thing happening over here. You can see the anterior displacement as well as medial displacement. So this is happening here, beautifully demonstrating the high condylar fracture. You can see the condyle itself laterally subluxated. You can see the high condylar fracture. So high condylar fracture or condylar process fractures are very much essential than the low condylar fractures. This is very much. And one important sign is empty glenoid fossa sign. Normal, this is the glenoid process. It should beautifully sit within it. This is the normal glenoid. Whenever it is fractured, we cannot able to see anything. This is called as empty glenoid fossa sign. Always, so it is anteromedially dislocated, what you are seeing here. Why it is anteromedially dislocated? Because the lateral pterygoid function is to pull it down, so it is going for anteromedial dislocation. That is very much essential. This is one among the case. You can see it is a ring, so there will be a fracture in mandible, fracture in the condylar neck, as well as you can see the condylar process is fractured. So all these things can occur. This is very much essential. You can see the 3D reconstruction beautifully demonstrating the fractures. And sometimes it may dislocate anteriorly. Instead of normal position, you can see it is dislocated. Patient not able to close the mouth. It will keep it in always in open position because not reducing back. For that, anesthesia is a must to reduce it back. This is very much essential. Whenever it is not treated properly, it will go for severe shortening as well as bony ankylosis. This is classical case of bony ankylosis of the TM joint. Because of continuous bruxism, the patient will have hypertrophy. This is a normal mesenteric muscle. You can see the hypertrophic mesenteric muscle. Sometimes it may be so severe. You can see like it is a very large temporalis as well as mesenteric muscle. This is called as Minotaur syndrome. So what are the take-home messages of TM joint imaging? Always we should do two positions. One is closed mouth position, other one is open mouth position. Always look for position of the TM. You can see the disc will be classical, you can see the appearance. Central will be, it is a bow tie configuration. Central will be low, and this is the posterior band, and this is the anterior band, this is the intermediate zone. Posterior band should be at 11 o'clock position. If it is coming anteriorly, means it is very much, it is dislocated. And this is superior belly of lateral pterygoid, direct attachment. Inferior belly will have attachment over the condylar process. And this is very much, it is normal. Same thing, you can see the normal. Whenever mouth is open, there is a translational movement from here. So it has come anteriorly. Beautifully, we can see the normal alignment. You can see the condylar process as well as condylar eminence. The disc will remain same position. This is very much essential. Whenever it is dislocated, you can see it is dislocated anteriorly. So when we are in closed mouth position, it is dislocated, but when you are doing open mouth, it has gone back. That means it is reasonably good. That means we can do something to save. It is very much as it is called as a disc derangement with reduction in open mouth position. And here you can see the disc is dislocated anteriorly. You can see how much it, you can see the globular wavy appearance, bright signals and abnormal position. It is below the condylar eminence. And when we are doing open mouth also, it is not going back at all. It is called as a disc derangement without reduction. It is very much essential. Stuck disc is the one which will look same in both closed as well as open mouth because of surrounding fibrosis and these things. And inflammatory conditions can occur. This is ankylosing spondylitis producing inflammatory changes. This is septic arthritis. And you can see the high condylar fracture where it can dislocate medially as well as anteriorly also. Thank you.